Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. JPA and Hibernate provide different methods to persist new and to update existing entities. You can choose between JPA's persist and merge and Hibernate's save and update methods. It seems like there are two pairs of methods that do the same. You can use the methods persist and save to store a new entity, and the methods merge and update to store the changes of a detached entity in the database. That's why a lot of developers are wondering which of these methods they should use. Let's take a closer look at the details and small differences of these methods. Before we get into the details of these four methods, I need to give you a quick introduction to JPA's entity lifecycle states. If an entity is attached to the current persistence context, it has the lifecycle state managed. That means that it is mapped to a database record. Your persistence provider generates the required SQL insert and update statements to propagate all changes. A managed entity is also stored in the first level cache. When you create a new entity, it's in the transient state. It remains in this state until you attach it to the current persistence context. I will show you how you can do that with JPA's persist and Hibernate save method in the following section. As long as an entity is in the transient state, it is not mapped to a database record and not matched by any persistence context. Entities in the detached lifecycle state are no longer managed by the persistence context. That can be the case because you closed the persistence context or you explicitly detached the entity from the current context. I will get into more details about how you can reattach these entities with JPA's merge and Hibernate's update methods in a later part of this video. And the last lifecycle state is removed. These entities were previously in the state managed before you scheduled them for removal. Removing entities is outside of the scope of this video, so I will not get into too many details about it. You can schedule an entity for removal by calling the remove method on the Entity Manager interface. When you create a new entity object, it's in the transient lifecycle state. It does not map any database record. You need to attach the entity to a persistence context so that it becomes managed and gets persisted in the database. You can either use JPA's persist or Hibernate save method to do that. Both methods seem to do the same, but there are a few differences. The most obvious difference is that the JPA specification defines the persist method. You can use it with all JPA implementations. The save method, on the other hand, is Hibernate specific. It is therefore not available in other JPA implementations. But that's only relevant if you want to be able to replace Hibernate with another JPA implementation like Eclipse Link or OpenGPA. Another obvious difference between these two methods is their return type. JPA's persist method returns void, and Hibernate save method returns the primary key of the entity. That might seem like a huge difference, especially when you take a closer look at Hibernate's Java doc and the JPA specification. The Java doc of Hibernate save method states that it generates the primary key value first. But you don't find any information about this in the JPA specification. It doesn't define when the primary key value has to be assigned. So the persistence provider can do that at any time between the call of the persist method and the flush of the persistence context. In most cases, it doesn't make any difference if you call the save or persist method. Hibernate uses the name of the entity class and the primary key value to store the entity in the first level cache. It therefore needs a primary key value when it executes the persist method. In almost all situations, Hibernate generates the primary key value immediately and triggers an SQL statement, if necessary, when you call the persist or save method. But that is not the case if you use the identity strategy and try to persist an entity without an active transaction or with flush mode manual. If you call the persist method in one of these situations, Hibernate delays the execution of the SQL insert statement and creates a temporary primary key value. But if you call the save method, Hibernate performs the SQL insert statement immediately and retrieves the primary key value from the database. For both methods, Hibernate generates and performs the same SQL statements. Which these are, and when Hibernate executes them, depends on your primary key generation strategy. Let's start with the easiest option and set the primary key value programmatically, for example, to a natural identifier. You can see the generated statements here. Hibernate flushed the persistence context when it committed the transaction and executed the SQL insert statement. That changes if you use the identity strategy to generate the primary key value. Hibernate now needs to execute the insert statement when you call the save or persist method to retrieve the primary key value from the database. And if you use a sequence, you enable Hibernate to decouple the generation of the primary key value from the execution of the insert statement. Hibernate performs an SQL statement to retrieve the next value from the database sequence when you call the persist or save method. Hibernate then delays the insert statement until it flushes the persistence context. In this example, the flush happens when the transaction gets committed. You shouldn't use the table strategy because it requires row-level locks on the primary key table and doesn't scale well. If you use this strategy anyways, you allow Hibernate to generate the primary key value first and insert the new record later. Hibernate performs an SQL select statement to retrieve the next primary key value from the database and writes the new value to the database table. It delays the execution of the SQL insert statement for the new entity until it flushes the persistence context. You could expect that the save and persist method behave differently because there are a few differences between the JPA specification and the Java doc of Hibernate's proprietary methods. But almost all of these differences disappear when you take a look at the internal implementation. The only ones that remain are two corner cases in which Hibernate might delay the retrieval of the primary key, the return type of the method, and the support by other JPA implementations. For most applications, it doesn't make any difference if you get the generated primary key value as the return type of Hibernate save method or from the getter method of your primary key attribute. As long as you don't use an extended persistence context and perform all database operations with an active transaction, I recommend using JPA's persist method. When you close the current persistence context or explicitly remove an entity from it by calling the clear or detach methods on the entity manager interface, the entity becomes detached. That means that it is no longer stored in the first level cache and that Hibernate will not replicate any of the applied changes to the database. You can use Hibernate's update or JPA's merge method to associate a detached entity with a persistence context. After you've done that, Hibernate will update the database based on the entity attribute values. The effect of the update and merge method seem to be the same, but as you will see in the following sections, there is an important difference. JPA's merge method copies the state of a detached entity to a managed instance of the same entity. Hibernate therefore executes an SQL select statement to retrieve a managed entity from the database. If the persistence context already contained a managed instance, Hibernate uses the existing one instead. It then copies all attribute values to the managed entity and returns it to the caller. Let's take a look at an example. I persist a new author entity with two typos. My first name is written with TH and my last name with 2S. Then I commit the transaction and close the entity manager. Entity A is now detached. Then I get a new entity manager and load the same database record before I fix the typo in the last name attribute on the managed entity and the typo in the first name attribute on the detached entity. Let's see what happens when I now merge the detached entity. You can see the executed SQL statements here. Hibernate loads the entity from the database, doesn't perform any SQL statement when I call the merge method, because the persistence context already contains a managed instance of the merged entity, and it then executes an SQL update statement when I commit the transaction. But which values did this update statement persist? Does it contain the changes performed on the managed and the detached entity? No, it doesn't. As you can see here, the S is still missing in my last name. So I lost the change I did on the managed entity. Hibernate overwrote it with the attribute values of the detached entity. Hibernate's update method doesn't trigger an SQL select statement. It just attaches the entity to the current persistence context. In contrast to JPA's merge method, you can't lose any changes by calling the update method. If the persistence context already contains a managed instance of the entity you want to update, it throws an exception. Here you can see the SQL statements Hibernate executes when you update an entity. It doesn't perform any dirty checks. That's not possible because Hibernate didn't read the latest version of the entity from the database. It just executes an SQL update statement for the reattached entity. The missing dirty check causes an unnecessary SQL update statement when the entity and the corresponding database record contain the same values. This might be a problem if your DBA registered an update trigger for the database table. In these situations, you can annotate your entity with select before update. That tells Hibernate to select the entity and perform a dirty check before it generates the SQL update statement. As you can see in the log output, the behavior of the update method is now similar to JPA's merge method. But there is a significant difference between the two methods. When you call the update method, Hibernate will only select the entity which you provided as a method parameter. But when you call JPA's merge method, Hibernate will also select all associations with cascade type merge. You should therefore prefer JPA's merge method if you reattach a huge graph of entities. So, which method should you use? Merge or update? There is no general answer to this question. As you have seen, both methods have their advantages and disadvantages. You have to decide for your specific use case if Hibernate needs to select the entity before it triggers the SQL update statement. And if that is the case, you also need to consider the depth of your entity graph and the performance implications of the provided fetching behavior. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video, and an ebook about using native queries with JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!